Hi, David. Welcome to Savvy Broadcasting, Life Unscripted. We're so grateful to have you out here. David is the founder of David Cook's Enterprises, LLC, a speaking, coaching, and training organization helping businesses and individuals get with their purpose, getting a handle on their purpose, and he's the author of the best-selling book, Getting Undressed, From Paralysis to Purpose. And it's a topic we've covered quite a bit on Savvy, people getting connected with their purpose, but sometimes that word just gets thrown about. Share with us, how did you get connected with your purpose?
Well, thank you. First of all, it is an honor to be with you today and with your audience. For me, you know, it was a journey, as I think it is for all of us. And, you know, I had a very a tragic situation when I was 15 years old, and I had a spinal aneurysm that literally in 24 hours turned my life around. I was a basketball player and 2 days away, literally from tryouts sophomore year. And one of the things I loved to do now was gone. And what was I going to do? And I never lost my passion for the game and for living. But as I began to have experiences throughout my life, I began to understand that I was gifted to do certain things. And one of them was to connect with people and to reach them and to impact their lives positively. And that's what I spent most of my life doing. And that's, what I consider to be my purpose, you know. And I think purpose is always bigger than we are anyway. Mm-hmm. Never for us, it's always for someone else. And as soon as I understood that and took some of the attention off of myself and my situation versus putting it on my purpose, it made my life a lot more fulfilling.
Wow, I like that you mentioned that, David, because I think I've talked to people over the years, they've been guests on the show, or even just personally, and say, oh, my purpose is to do acting or whatever it might be. And we get so tied up in the thing or the action steps or that little thing that sounds really good. Maybe it's being a veterinarian. When I was a kid, I wanted to be a veterinarian. But what I found interesting, David, is that sometimes all the life experiences lead us to a position that we would have never expected, but that all of life kind of prepares us for where we really should be. And we don't really have to struggle. If we just kind of go with our natural gifts and talents, it kind of just flows there.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. You know, and I think I talk to people all the time and I ask them, well, what is it that you are just naturally gifted to do? Because that is going to be probably the conduit or the source to getting you to your destiny and your purpose. It's not going to be something that you can't do. It's not going to be something that you find difficult to do. You should enjoy your purpose. You should enjoy that gift and use that gift and realize that it's given to you for the benefit of everyone else. And that's absolutely where I tell people to begin when they want to know, well, where is my purpose? Well, what are you gifted to do? What is it that naturally comes to you? And start there.
See, what's really cool about this, David, is that I think we take those things for granted. For me, in high school, I was just telling the story to my friend yesterday. I want to be an opera singer. But it's so funny because you're like, I don't want to just be an opera singer. I want to sing at the Met. So I remember going to an audition saying to one of the top vocal trainers, oh, I want to sing at the Met. I want to be an opera star. And she's like, I don't know about that. But, you know, then now over the years, I'm like, but the thing that gave me most joy was just being with people and listening to them. And that kind of led me in my 40s to what I'm doing today right here with you. So it's interesting. Sometimes you take for granted, you don't even notice what your purpose is because you're so busy thinking of what the world tells you, maybe being a lawyer, a doctor, a singer, that sort of thing.
Yeah, often we overlook what's right in front of us. It's right in front of our eyes. It's what we're doing. And we always seem to think it's a different opportunity or there's a better opportunity. And normally, it's the opportunity that we have that leads us further to the next situation. And we just can't overlook the simple things. It's not that complicated, I don't think. I think a lot of times it's right in our eyes and in our hands, literally, and we are looking for something else, something that's a little more sexy or something a little more attractive. And you don't realize that it's so impactful, just the little things that you have. Because I personally believe that the most powerful thing that we have is our stories. And the story that we can tell about our lives can impact so many people.
Wow. Now, that's interesting. Share that with me. Do you really believe that everyone's story can actually add not only value, but really help people? How does that work out? Tell me your perspective.
Well, I think that we all have a journey and that we all have struggles and that we all have things that we have overcome. Mm-hmm. And somebody is out there that will benefit from your specific situation. Mm. If you don't that. And if you don't share that, then you may be missing some of what you need to do in life. And oftentimes, I just think that we think everybody needs to have a great, great story that you overcome so many things. For some people, it may just be graduating from high school, or it may be getting that first job. That's a story. And that can inspire people, because people still inspire people. That's the truth.
You know, it's funny. There's a top salesperson that says information tells. No, he said stories sell, information tells, or something like that, or facts, something like that. But anyway, the purpose was that really, if you want to really grow your business, it's about building the stories and relationships, not so much about putting out the information. I'm great. I'm wonderful. I can do this, that, and the other for you. And something I'm picking up from you also about your purpose and doing what you're meant to do, it's really about getting the focus off of you and putting the focus on others.
Yes. Yeah. I think that's the beginning of the process. It's important to have self-care and make sure that you're in a good place. So let's put that out there. But at the same time, it can't always be about you. It can't always be about you. And I think when you serve, and we should be in the business of serving all the time. All successful people are servers. Great leaders are servers. That's what they do. That's what we do. And when you begin to realize that you are helping somebody else's experience become better, it actually benefits you too. I mean, there are literally studies out there that talk about how blood pressure and sugar levels and all those things go down when we serve other people. Yeah. And I think in everyone's purpose in life, there is a portion of that is involved in serving others and helping others.
Wow. What's so powerful about what you're saying here, David, is there's a friend of mine who's a attorney. He's done it for 20 years, hated it. And recently just totally started a whole new company that's totally different than you would have ever imagined. It's a product-based, something that people can eat and it's yummy, but he's now happier than ever. But it's funny, he would have never thought doing what he's doing and that product he's putting out is the thing he's meant to do. He thought, I'm serving people. He would go into underprivileged places and just, you know, be an attorney to help people, but he hated it. And my thought now is that if you don't love what you're doing, and you put yourself out there, even if you think, hey, what I'm doing is serving people, but I'm not able to bring my best to the table. So how much am I able to serve people in the best way I can?
Absolutely. I agree with you. If I tell people this too, that if you're unhappy doing what you're doing, that means you probably shouldn't be doing it much longer. Mm-mm. There should be some joy in everything that you do. If it's not making you better, I think you got to get rid of it. Yeah. I don't care what it is or who it is. You've got to get rid of that and be able to present, like you said, your best self. Mm-hmm. And that best self should be happy, because who wants to be around someone that's not happy? I can't do that.
No, absolutely. But also, you know, for what's interesting, a lot of people that have come on the show in the past as guests, some of the things that's propelled them into great success and building the business that they never even dreamed they would was a crisis or adversity that happened in their lives. And it turned out to be the greatest gift in a sense, because it actually pushed them in a direction they probably wouldn't have gone had they not gotten a little bump. How do you find that adversity has helped you, or maybe others, you know, find their purpose and go out there and live their best life?
Yeah. For me, when I wrote the book, Getting Undressed from Paralysis to Purpose, I began to understand. People ask me all the time, would you be who you are today if you didn't have what happened to you happen? And first of all, I'd say, I don't know that, but I know that I wouldn't be who I am today if I didn't have the paralysis, if I didn't have the wheelchair, if I didn't have all these life experiences. Mm-hmm. And adversity doesn't redefine your purpose. It redirects you sometime to how you get to your purpose. Mm-hmm. And that's how I look at adversity. Adversity and obstacles give you the opportunity to continue to score and win in life. Mm. And the moment you stop learning is when you start losing. And I think that we have the opportunity to win all of our lives if we will take whatever situations we have. Mm-hmm. And instead of asking why, and it's okay. I tell people, it's okay to ask why, but don't stay there. After you ask why and you don't get the answer, then you need to start asking, how can I learn? How can I grow? And how can I serve? If we can get to that point, and I've been able to get there, and it's not always easy. I've cried. I've had days I didn't want to do it. I've had ups and I've had downs. Mm-hmm. I've had an awful lot of wins. And I keep learning. And I think that's the key as you take a look at adversity. Again, it doesn't redefine who you are. It doesn't redefine your goals. It doesn't redefine your purpose, but it can redirect you and take you on a different route than you thought you were going to take.
What's interesting about that, David, is that it also allows you when you're in those difficult spots to realize that, you know, this could be the thing that actually turns lemon into lemonade, yeah?
Yes.
It's a difficult situation, but what I find, and this is what happened for me when my health started to deteriorate a number of years ago, and I took a step back and said things need to be changed, I probably would have not changed my course and found where I am today had I not said, okay, this is not working. You know, you get to a point in your life, what do I do to change? And sometimes those moments are the perfect time for you to reshift and go out there in a bigger way.
Oh, absolutely. None of us are inviting pain and misery in our life. But I think it's at those points of pain that we probably find out more about ourselves and more about where we should go than when things aren't, than when things are going really, really well.
Yeah. Yeah. So tell me, what do you do when you start talking to someone, they want to work with you, and they say, I have no idea what my purpose is? How do you even begin to help them peel back the onion and discover, you know, what their great gifts are?
Well, it really starts with the basic question of, what are you passionate about? Tell me some things that you're passionate about. Then tell me what you're skilled about. And then let's see if we can combine those. And after we get to that point of, give me three or four things you'd love to do. Now give me three or four things that you are really good at. Mm-hmm. And then how can you put this together to help make somebody else's life better? And eventually we come down to God-given gifts and abilities, mm-hmm. and a drive to be successful. And I think that's where we start. I think everyone needs to start and just find out, what are you gifted to do? If there was, you know, and I don't believe in the old saying, well, what would you do if you couldn't get paid? Well, nothing, because I'm not doing that.
I like that.
But you know, what is it that you would do where money doesn't matter? One of the quotes in my book says that money matters, but not at the expense of purpose.
Mm.
And I believe that if there's something that you could do that you felt would fulfill you, let's start with that. And let's see what natural giftings that you have. Those natural giftings will lead the way. Basketball was a gift, was the conduit for me, and coaching was what I used, but my ability to speak and connect to people was really the gift that I have and my ability to speak. So that's why I speak to companies and do all that kind of stuff. I'm gifted to do that. And yeah. once I stopped fighting that, and I fought that for a while because I thought that wasn't, you know, quite good enough. Once you stop fighting the things that you just naturally can do, I'm telling you, you're on your way to finding your purpose. And purpose is interesting. Purpose requires that you arrive alone, but you can get help along the way. Mm. And so you are uniquely gifted to fulfill your purpose and your purpose only. You can't fulfill anybody else's. And that's one of the challenges when I talk to people about the dangers of comparison. Making comparisons, because you have to learn how to glean from others, knowing that their purpose is not your purpose. And only you can fulfill your purpose with what you've been given. And that's the challenge and the focus that I think people have to have.
Wow, that is so instrumental and makes so much sense. But you also touched on something there that was really important, is that I don't believe in what would you do for no money, because the whole purpose is, if you're giving value, you should be getting paid or getting value back in some form. And it's interesting because I've heard so many people start, well, if I really want to help people, I should go out there and just be a doctor in a, you know, rural place and not get paid. I'm like, well, no, you need to pay your medical school tuition back and stuff like that. There is realistically, you need to get back on track and pay for your own living expenses. So the idea that if you're doing your purpose, sometimes you shouldn't get paid for it you don't help anyone that way.
You don't help anyone. Well, no. You know, you can't give what you don't have, mm-hmm. and you need some stuff to give in order to give it. And so that whole notion of not having anything and not being paid, I just think that sends the wrong message, and it also is counterintuitive to the human nature. Mm-hmm. I mean, we all want to succeed and have things and share things, and so go for it, you know. Yeah. And because you know what, if if you are able, if you are really committed to serving, you don't have a problem with giving. Mm-hmm. And that means you don't have a problem with receiving. And that is so important, because then you know it's not for you anyway. Mm-hmm. And you just keep giving and you keep getting, you keep giving, you keep getting. And what a great cycle to get into.
It is. And you just mentioned something there, cycle. And someone had once said to me, if you're not comfortable receiving, you're not really giving.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
It's a circle. It's a cycle. If you don't do that, if you stop the giving, if you stop the receiving, you're stopping the giving.
Right. And it's interesting, yeah. You know, we think there's some kind of humility, extra humility in not receiving. I don't know where we get these things from. It actually humbles you to learn how to receive. I do think it's easier to give. And especially if you're a giver and someone's trying to give you something, like, well, you know, that's okay. I don't, you know, from a wheelchair standpoint, and I've been in a wheelchair 40 years now, the older I got, the more I was receptive to receiving help, mm-hmm. because people were genuinely wanting to serve me. And mm-hmm. I was turning that away. And I didn't know how to receive that. Mm-hmm. And the older I got, I'm like, man, let me let these people hold the door and put my groceries in the trunk or whatever they're asking to do. The answer is now yes. And I've learned how to receive that, change my life.
Yeah, we could talk for hours, but I don't want people to leave without finding out how they can get in contact with you, work with you, and get your awesome book. How can they do that?
Okay. You can go to my website, which is davidcooksspeaks.com. Mm-hmm. And all my information is there. I am on social media, all the social media outlets as well. And my book is called Getting Undressed from Paralysis to Purpose. And that's available at my website, on Amazon.com, and also at your local Barnes and Noble stores. And you will probably find me speaking somewhere. I'm really excited to actually join the stage in October with Elizabeth Smart, which is going to be a great opportunity. And so I love sharing my story with people, and I would love to come to a city near you soon.
Yes, I know that your story will inspire others and hopefully inspire them to get out there, share their own story so they can impact others and find their true potential, their skills and passion, and go out there and deliver as well. So thank you so much, Dave, for coming today to Savvy Broadcasting, a Life Unscripted, and sharing your wonderful wisdom. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.